Good afternoon. We gather today to commemorate and celebrate the life of Harry Joseph Middleton Jr. and what an accomplished and impactful life he crowded into his 95 years. On behalf of his children, Jim Middleton, Susan Hoyle, Debbie Sansom, and Jennifer O'Dell, I welcome you here and thank you for coming for this ceremony to honor Harry today. We're going to start the program with an invocation by his dear, dear friend of many years, Lynda Robb.
Larry's blessing. I don't know that I can live up to what he does, but I had the opportunity a few weeks ago to come down and spend 2 days with Harry Middleton. And they are days that I will always cherish. His mother says, you know, there are two lists, those that I wish I had and I'm glad I did. And Harry is right up at the top of my list, I'm glad I did. And so I ask you to think about Harry as I read these words from St. Paul. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness. And when I thought of that, I also remembered Harry's wonderful sense of humor. So this prayer may not be quite from any of the biblical parts that Paul or anybody else used. Life should not be a journey to the grave with the intention of arriving safely in an attractive and well-preserved body, but rather to skid in sideways, chocolate in one hand, wine in the other, body thoroughly used up, totally worn out, and screaming, "Woohoo! What a ride!" God bless Harry.
Most of the people in this hall will remember Harry as the longtime legendary director of this LBJ Library, the dean of all directors who ever served any of the 13 presidential libraries, the man who is called the gold standard of presidential library directors. Historian Michael Beschloss called him the Joe DiMaggio of presidential library directors. Yes, Harry earned those accolades and stature at the pinnacle among his peers. But it is important to recall and recite that there was much more to Harry Middleton than the 30 years he served as this library's director. I want to take you through some of that career briefly today. Harry was first, foremost, and always a writer. Harry once said that even as a youth, growing up in Kansas, he assumed he would live a productive life as a writer because he was constantly scribbling essays, poems, and stories. He was the most gifted wordsmith I ever knew. His writing talents were the hallmark of his remarkable career. When World War II began, Harry Middleton dropped out of college at Washburn University in Topeka, his hometown, and entered the Army. He worked in the Army's information offices and on camp newspapers at several institutions. After he was discharged from the Army, he continued his education at Louisiana State University, where he was editor of the school newspaper before he received his journalism degree in 1947. Then he started his prolific journey as a journalist, reporter, and historian in New York with the Associated Press. In that capacity, he covered and wrote about Eleanor Roosevelt, who was then the United States representative to the UN, and many other activists and actors on the public stage of that time, including Henry Wallace, New York Mayor William O'Dwyer, Harry Bridges, Tallulah Bankhead, Dorothy Parker, and Paul Robeson. It was during that time that he met a Columbia graduate student named Miriam Miller, who would become the engaging Miriam Middleton, beloved by many of us. After the AP, Harry became news editor of Architectural Forum, a magazine that was published by Time, Inc. But when the Korean War broke out, Harry was recalled into the Army, this time with a commission as an historical officer. Harry's job was to chronicle the war, and boy, did he succeed. Many years later, Harry wrote a book called The Compact History of the Korean War, which still today is the single most important and definitive history of the Korean War. After the war, Harry was hired for another Time Inc. project, trying to convert the old March of Time movie theater newsreels into the then new medium of television. But that wasn't his bag, and he didn't last there long. So Harry then embarked on almost a decade of freelance writing. Then, as now, the economic fortunes of a freelance writer were precarious. He could only get paid if his articles were good enough for publication. Harry's were. He wrote articles and stories for leading magazines of the day, including Reader's Digest, Collier's, Cosmopolitan, and Life. I personally find it humorous that even though Harry Middleton never had much interest in or knowledge about sports, he was accomplished enough in his craft that he was able to write multiple articles published in Sports Illustrated. While freelancing, Harry wrote a novel entitled Pax. Regrettably, it is now out of print. Luann Temple says that this funny, edgy, and timely satire demonstrates that Harry Middleton was the equal of Christopher Buckley before there was a Christopher Buckley. The door that got Harry Middleton into government opened in 1966. President Lyndon Johnson had established a commission to study the selective service system. Now, for those of you in the audience who are the contemporaries of my grandchildren, I would note that that was what we call the draft, the conscription of young men to serve in the military. Harry was hired by the commission to participate in its study and deliberations and to write the final report of the work of the commission, which he did. That final report caught the eye of President Johnson, who called Harry into the White House, Harry's first meeting with LBJ, and LBJ asked him to draft a presidential message to Congress based on the commission's report. Harry tells the story that LBJ never really hired him or offered him a job. Rather, the president simply gave Harry other writing assignments, and Joe Califano told him that he should just assume that he was now working for the president. He did. He eventually became the staff assistant to the president up through the end of the president's term. Many of the speeches, proclamations, and statements of LBJ in 1967 and 1968 were the handiwork of Harry Middleton. I know, because he told me, that he was particularly proud of the statement given by President Johnson when he signed the Fair Housing Act, banning discrimination in the sale, rental, and financing of housing. An excerpt from Harry's remarkable prose is on the back of your program. When he returned to Austin in 1969, President Johnson enticed Harry to come with him. Harry, Bob Hardesty, Walt Rostow, and Doris Kearns Goodwin assisted President Johnson in the writing of his memoirs, The Vantage Point, and his other book, The Choices We Face. When those projects were completed, LBJ asked Harry to become director of the LBJ Library, a position that he held for more than 30 years. At the time of the dedication of this library, LBJ famously said, "It's all here. The story of our time with the bark off." LBJ's aspiration was for the library to be transparent and accessible for scholars and to be the forum for lively discussions of the issues of the day. Harry Middleton made that aspiration a reality. Historians, scholars, and researchers all uniformly acclaim that the LBJ Library is the most open and accessible of any of the presidential libraries. There are no secrets here. There never has been any effort to hide or downplay any negative or disappointing aspect of the LBJ legacy. For example, the Vietnam War is prominent for research, discussion, and exhibit. Credit that to Harry Middleton. Moreover, Harry made sure that the library was and is the center of dialogue and discussion of all the prominent topics of the day. Discord and controversy have never been avoided at the presidential, at the LBJ Library, and civility and respect for the opinions and views of all have been the standard. Those were the standards established by Harry Middleton. Harry Middleton's boldest and probably most enduring action as director of the LBJ Library related to the LBJ secret telephone tapes. As everyone now knows, but didn't then, LBJ taped many, but not all, of the telephone conversations he had during his presidency in the White House. His instruction was that the telephone tapes were not to be publicly released until 50 years after his death in 1973. That was an effort on his part simply to protect others and their privacies and not having their feelings hurt. Under that instruction, the world would not have known the substance, persuasiveness, and often colorful language of LBJ's conversations until 2023. In 1993, though, consistent with President Johnson's initial charge to make everything in the library as open and accessible as soon as possible, Harry concluded that it was timely and appropriate to try to override the president's 50-year restriction and open and release the tapes. He sought the support of Lady Bird Johnson, which she very readily gave. Now, let me tell you just how courageous, and I truly mean courageous, that action was by Harry Middleton and Lady Bird Johnson. Harry had only heard the contents of a handful of tapes. Lady Bird Johnson had not heard a single solitary tape. They did not know what was on the tapes when they made the decision to open them to the public. Could there have been something explosive in the tapes? Could there have been something embarrassing in the tapes? Of course there could. But the opening of the tapes gave the world a glimpse and an insight on the real Lyndon Johnson. You can hear him agonize over the Vietnam War. You can hear him cajole and persuade members of Congress to support his programs. You can hear the funny stories of this master storyteller. In sum, the telephone tapes give the listener a contemporaneous, behind-the-scenes look at one of the most consequential presidents of all time. In reporting on the release of the tapes, Texas Monthly labeled Harry Middleton as the man who saved Lyndon Johnson. When I suggested to Harry at one time that it was truly LBJ who had saved LBJ, Harry said he liked the Texas Monthly label better. Speaking of titles, the dapper Harry Middleton was once labeled by New York Society columnist Liz Smith as the sexiest man in Austin. Well, Harry loved that compliment, but sometimes intentionally, incorrectly remembered that Liz had said he was the sexiest man in the world. While directing the LBJ Library, Harry continued his writing. His introductions of participants at this library still are classics that others plagiarize today. But he was also the go-to guy to edit papers and speeches for Lynda Robb, Luci Johnson, Tom Johnson, George Christian, me, and many others. In addition, Harry wrote two widely acclaimed books during his time, LBJ, The White House Years in 1990, and Lady Bird Johnson, A Life Well Lived in 1992. When Harry retired after more than 30 years as director of the LBJ Library in 2002, he created and taught a course on the LBJ presidency for the University of Texas History and Government majors. Mark Updegrove co-taught that course 1 year with Harry and then picked it up after Harry retired from teaching. That course continues today under the scholarship of Mark Lawrence. Lady Bird Johnson endowed the Harry J. Middleton Lecture that is brought to the library Soviet President Mikhail Gorbachev, Presidents Gerald Ford and Jimmy Carter, and Supreme Court Justice Sandra Day O'Connor, among many, many, many other notables, some of whom are here today. Harry wore two hats and held the position of executive director of the LBJ Foundation all of the 30-plus years he was director of the library. When he retired, the foundation created the Harry Middleton Fellowship to support students and historians researching the American presidency at the library. Lyndon Johnson's name is on this library, but Harry Middleton's fingerprints and footprints are all over it. The LBJ Library is what it is today because of Harry Middleton, and it is not hyperbole, it's not exaggeration when I say the presidential library system for all 13 presidential libraries are what they are today because of the pattern of what Harry Middleton did and the precedent that he set. I am reminded of a country and western song that was popular in the 1990s that recited the talents and abilities of Willie Nelson, Waylon Jennings, and other prominent singers of the time. It ends with the refrain, "It don't matter who's in Austin, Bob Wills is still the king." Well, I will say to you that it doesn't matter who serves as a director of any presidential library anywhere, Harry Middleton is and will always be the king.
Members of the Middleton family, ladies and gentlemen, we all lost a good friend last month. I lost a mentor. We also all knew this day was coming, as did Harry, who expressed in very specific detail how he wanted it all to go. And yet somehow it came as a surprise when he passed away. But when he left this earth after 95 good years, the ardent Democrat who labored to help and build LBJ's great society did so in the waning hours of the administration of the first African-American president and before the inauguration of the 45th president. How did we not see that coming? One of the many things I admired about Harry was his mastery of the English language. It was for that reason that Harry fatefully entered into the orbit of Lyndon Johnson as a speechwriter toward the latter years of the Johnson administration. Winston Churchill once said, "Words at great moments of history are deeds." Harry put the words around the most prodigious deeds of one of our most consequential presidents during the most historic of times on paper. After the assassination of Martin Luther King, which saw the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1968, better known as the Fair Housing Act, it fell to Harry to draft a speech for LBJ to deliver upon the bill's signing. On that great occasion, as Larry Temple indicated, Harry wrote the following: "I do not exaggerate when I say that the proudest moments of my presidency have been times such as this, when I have signed into law the promises of a century." An aide who read a draft of the speech told Harry that since he didn't know what the president really felt about the matter, maybe he shouldn't write "the proudest moments of my presidency," but rather "some of the proudest moments of my presidency." "Let's ask the president," Harry said. They did, and the passage stayed as written. As the story suggests, Harry had a good feeling for what LBJ was thinking, and LBJ trusted Harry. Still, it came as a shock to Harry when former President Lyndon Johnson asked him to run the LBJ Presidential Library, especially since Harry had no experience in such things. But Harry, in the parlance of LBJ, was a can-do man, and the only resume requirement LBJ often had for those in whom he had great faith was that they were can-do people. Harry always said that he was glad that there was an opening at the LBJ Library and not the LBJ Ranch. If he knew little about presidential libraries, he knew a whole lot less about Texas Longhorns. LBJ showed us his wisdom and eye for talent in tapping Harry for the directorship of this library, and Harry did us all a great service by taking it. After I took the helm As director of the library in 2009, Harry became one of my closest friends. For a long time, every month, we would get together for dinner at the Headliners Club, where I heard much about Harry's wonderful journey through this world, often over a bottle or two of red wine. Since he presided over the presidential library that, as Larry indicated, was celebrated for relating the history with, as LBJ had said, the bark off, I will relate two stories relating to Harry in the same spirit. One of my favorite stories from Harry was of him going to Vietnam in the mid-1960s to film a documentary on the Vietnam War. It spoke to Harry's charmed life that his traveling companion was legendary actor John Wayne. At the time, the US government talked about the importance of Americans winning the hearts and minds of the Vietnamese people. John Wayne saw it differently. As he told Harry, grab them by the balls and their hearts and minds will follow. One of my favorite stories about Harry involves the F word. The, at times, irreverent Harry Middleton, I know, would love the fact that we invoked the F word at his memorial service. So hold on to your seats. During a dinner after a Harry Middleton lecture featuring guests Bryan Cranston and Robert Schenken, who talked about Schenken's Broadway play All the Way, there was much talk about how frequently the word, the F word, was used throughout the course of the play. LBJ simply didn't use the words that much, LBJ aides contended. Among them was Tom Johnson, who stood up and made a toast to Schenken, during which he said, Robert, I channeled LBJ from the great ranch in the sky earlier today, and he said he simply didn't use the F word all that often. After which, Harry got up and said, that's interesting, Tom, because I channeled LBJ from the great ranch in the sky earlier today, and he wondered what the fuck you're talking about. Harry and I had disagreements about many things. I used to argue, not convincingly apparently, that the title of sexiest man in Austin, bestowed on him by Liz Smith, should be passed along to the current director of the LBJ Library. By all rights, I told him I should inherit it, but he refused to give it up. In return, I refused to give up the position of director of LBJ Library because I knew that Harry was often calling up Marge Morton to ask her if she would help overthrow me to get his damn job back. But in fact, Harry didn't need to come back to the LBJ Library because in essence, he never left. Sure, Betty Sue Flowers and I were given the keys and the charge to run the place, but Harry was always here with us, at least in spirit. President and Mrs. Johnson provided their vision for the library that bears President Johnson's name, but it was Harry who made it so. The LBJ Presidential Library became the first modern presidential library, the one that set the standard and continues to do so today. That might sound like a Texas brag, but it has a whole lot to do with a boy from Kansas. Betty Sue was, and I am, the steward of a national treasure, and a tradition that was forged by Harry Middleton, the Dean of Presidential Library Directors. Though he left this world, a part of Harry will always be here. This, after all, is the house that Harry built. Here are a few memories of our dear friend, the Director Emeritus of the LBJ Presidential Library, Harry J. Middleton.
Ladies and gentlemen, the 36th President of the United States, the Honorable Lyndon Baines Johnson.
She has worked with presidents, walked with kings, and dined with queens of all sexes.
Throughout her glamorous career, and particularly over the last few months in the wake of her successful book, Liz Smith has been introduced so often and so colorfully that introducing her now presents a daunting challenge. It's rather like being the new husband of a much-married movie queen. I know what to do. I'm just not quite sure how to do it differently enough to make it interesting.
The conversation that I have great cause to remember took place by on the telephone. He was at the LBJ Ranch, and I was here at the library, and it was so significant to me that I literally remember every word of it, including even the unprintable word was emblazoned in my mind. And he said he wanted everything open, and then he made it clear that that applied to him, too. He did not want anything held back that reflected in any way unfavorably on him. And sensing my discomfort with that, I guess, he said, you know, good men have been trying to protect my reputation for 40 years, and not a damn one has succeeded. Now, what makes you think you can?
You're a gentleman and a scholar and a producer, and I love you.
Oh, bullshit, Mr. President.
As a student of history, engaging with the primary source documents in the LBJ Library, which Mr. Middleton created, was one of the highlights of the class, as well as engaging with the living primary sources of our distinguished speakers and getting to engage with them, I think, was what I really enjoyed about the class.
Most professors study a subject, and then they regurgitate it. Harry Middleton knows the subject by heart because he loved it, and that's something that you can't really imitate.
And these voices of caution weighed very, very heavily on him. But they were trumped by voices urging action. The military said, take this action that General Westmoreland wants, and it will turn the tide of the war. Out of all the voices urging action, the most persuasive was that of Secretary of State Dean Rusk, who warned of the consequences of not taking this action.
Thank you, Professor Middleton.
That's a mister.
Today he comes to us as the first distinguished lecturer in a series endowed by Lady Bird Johnson in the name of Harry Middleton, director of this library. Harry has been this library's splendid director for 25 years. He is the dean. He is the Dean of the Presidential Library Directors, a devoted friend, and I think one of the finest writers and public servants of our time.
Thank you, Marcus. Good to be here again and to be in the library of a man who helped shape my life and for whom I have the greatest admiration and appreciation. When I was governor, and after Lyndon Johnson left office, I wrote him a personal letter, a handwritten letter, and sent it out here. I don't know if you still have it or not, but if you don't, you might want to look it up. I don't imagine they threw it away, but I'm not sure about that. But if you find it, I'd like a copy of it because I just hand-wrote it on an airplane trip.
I see you stand like greyhounds in the slip, straining upon the start. The game's afoot. Follow your spirits, and upon this charge, cry, God for Harry, England, and St. George! I hear I must apologize to Harry Middleton. He had asked me, when doing Henry V, to do the Crispin's Day speech. I had totally forgotten. And last night, I retired to my room in a panic. And then I resolved that any Shakespeare quotation that had God for Harry in it should stay. So my apologies.
And I'm wondering, when you were coming up in the world, who were your role models?
My parents. I didn't know any children, you know, out on the ranch, frankly. And I went to live with my grandmother. I guess she was to go to school in El Paso. She was a nonstop talker. And if her eyes were open, her lips were moving. I had to learn a lot about doing my work and never hearing a word she said. I don't know if that's helped me or not. Maybe it did.
Mr. President, how will history regard you?
Как вы думаете, какое место вы займете в истории? Как вас оценит история?
Хорошее.
Good. Good. The answer is good.
Но это шутка.
That's a joke.
Вторая шутка. Вторая шутка. История дама капризная.
My second joke is that history is a fickle lady.
Но я горжусь тем, что я так прожил.
I'm proud of the life that I have lived.
А история пусть разбирается.
And let history decide.
Луци.
When you're trying to find that core, is it an epiphany or does it come through a longer process as you're getting to know the character?
It could be either, and you're open to anything. Mm-hmm. So you don't know when something is going to resonate within you. We had a dinner not too long ago with Harry Middleton and Larry Temple, and just in casual conversation, Larry said something that really resonated with me, as did Harry, but it was interesting because it was offhanded about how every day except Sunday, is it all right to tell this, Larry? Okay. He would dress up as a woman and go... No? Oh, not that one? Oh, okay, not that. Okay. All right.
And apparently you put on an impotent mustache. Mm-hmm. I understand. Is that correct?
Take on a high voice. No. Not that one. No, I won't tell that one.
Well, farewell, Harry. It's so sad to see you leave where you belong. You're done so well, Harry. We can tell, Harry. You're still glowing, you're still crowing, you're still going strong.
When Harry came along, he set the pattern, he set the standard of openness, of objectivity, and of accessibility for presidential libraries. And the other libraries had to follow suit.
I realize that I've known Harry exactly half of his life. 45 years ago, we met in the White House, and we've been friends ever since. And I want to tell you that he's one of the best friends I've ever had.
Thank you, Harry, and thank you for many years and much dedication to making this one of the jewels in the crown of the presidential libraries. We all appreciate everything that you have done.
You
You've instilled in every person in this room a sense of value. So as we celebrate the gift of your life, we want you to know what a gift you've been to all of our lives.
I was asked to speak in Washington, and they were honoring my good friend over here, Mr. Tom Johnson. So I called my friend, Harry Middleton, and said, Harry, could you write me up something that I can say about Tom? You know, there's going to be a lot of fancy people here, and I want to sound really good. And he kind of sighed and said, I'm already writing Tom's speech.
I know that a number of nice things are going to be said tonight, and my great disappointment is that Bishop McCarthy left, because my opening line was going to be to the bishop saying, it's all been said, what are we going to do for my funeral? But I appreciate it all. I truly do. It was wonderful to hear all of those things, and I agree with them all. So thank you.
All you fellow admirers of Harry, it's been a great adventure. How lucky we are that Lyndon picked you. And we've done, I think, a good job of the mammoth job that you attempted. Thank you for a lifetime. In the morning
sun. And when the night is new, I'll be looking at the moon. But I'll be seeing you.
Hi, I'm Joshua Hoyle, and when I think of my grandfather, I think first of his magnetic personality and that he was always fun to be around. It was the combination of intelligence, wit, and love of life that made this magnetism. It was more than that that made him so admirable, though. It was the kindness and consideration he displayed toward everyone he encountered, no matter who they were, their station in life, or the situation. I think this is why he had so many friends. There are some people who are entertaining and smart and interesting, but you don't necessarily admire them without that other quality, that kind and sympathetic nature. He had all of these qualities from the earliest that I can remember through his 90s. His colleagues, friends, as well as the employees at the Westminster Retirement Home in his later years, got to know those traits. His family was important to him, and so were his friends. Grandpa, as I'll refer to him, but really he liked for me to call him Mr. Middleton. or the French grand-père, had many decades-old friends, and I saw to some extent the way that he and those friends helped each other. I think he had so many friends because of the way he treated people. He was friendly to everyone, and he treated everyone equally. He took an interest in the people around him, not because it might benefit him later on to do so, but because it was his nature. Although he was an extremely accomplished person in a variety of ways and had a great career and all of that, I think that what we will most vividly remember about him is the way that through the warmth and energy of his personality, he made everyone around him happier, and simply the number of friends that he made. Although I am biased, I really think it would have been impossible not to like him and be glad to have known him. I also want to mention that a big part of Grandpa's personality and character was his love of humor, and particularly of funny, true, or almost true, stories from his life. You all know that he loved to tell the same stories over and over again. And of course, this was because he wanted to share the humor he found in them with everyone. Some of us have favorites, which I won't try to repeat because I won't tell them well, but they will be remembered in conjunction with his great personality for a long time. And along with all this was a natural ability for and inclination toward leadership. And he was able to exhibit leadership without ever being mean or severe, which may be a rare thing. I also imagine that this special set of characteristics was appreciated by and enabled him to help the students who took his classes at the university. Of course, his passing leaves a void, but we, particularly the younger generation in our family, have learned from his example and will use and benefit from it into the future. And on behalf of Grandpa's other grandchildren, Monica, Lindsay, and Reed, as well as his new great-grandson, Charlie, I mentioned the broader importance of his family to him and the gratitude we have for that. I really think his family was the most important thing to him. And I bet that if anyone had ever gone against the family, he would have sent them a stern and extremely well-written letter. The importance of his family to him was evident to me from the time he was middle-aged until the end of his life. I think that among his favorite times were those when his family and extended family were nearby. And in every one of those family gatherings we've had over the past 13 years, he's made a point of mentioning my grandmother, Miriam. In his later years, he always chose to mention and ask us to remember Miriam at a time when we were all together, maybe at the beginning or end of a meal, when everyone was sure to hear it and appreciate it. And I think the significance of this is self-evident. I really think that that part of the reason he lived such a long life was the joy that he got from his family and friends. And he mentioned to me a couple of times that he wanted this day to be a happy, celebratory day where we remembered a lot of good things. So I will conclude on that note. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Luci Baines Johnson, and I'm just one more member of Harry Middleton's extended family, looking around this room and wondering how on earth can we be at the library that Harry built, and he's not here. He's as much a part of the soul of this institution as Daddy and Mother. And so it seemed only right to me that I come tonight wearing the suit that I wore to my father's centennial and the suit that I wore to my mother's funeral, because Harry indeed was there at these pinnacle moments in our lives for over half a century. And oh, how much better life was because he was a part of it. Dr. Samuel Johnson, the renowned author of the Oxford English Dictionary, once wrote, "When you're tired of London, you're tired of life." Harry Middleton, like my mother, was never tired of life. Mother and Harry were the most curious people I ever knew until the day they died, admonishing me that a day without learning was a day that was wasted. Neither Harry or Mother ever wasted a one. Harry honored me greatly when he asked me to write this tribute. My words can never do justice by Harry, for his words and deeds were endless tributes to my family. But since you asked me, Harry, I will try. You never let me down. I want to do right by you as long as I draw breath. And Harry, I am so grateful that I had the opportunity to take this tribute to you for your critique. It was the only speech I ever wrote that you didn't try to shorten. Harry, you were the best at so much. Enlisted man, officer, journalist, speechwriter, author, presidential library director, friend, family man, sartorial raconteur, and professor. You were all about excellence. Universally admired and loved, you remained a modest man with one notable exception, as Larry has already said. You adored reminding everyone that a fellow journalist once described you as the sexiest man in Austin. It grew, of course, to be the sexiest man in Texas and the sexiest man in America and probably the sexiest man in the universe. And to so many of us, he really was. To the day you died, you were the most debonair man in the room. Harry, you were our go-to guy. You provided us with wit and wisdom, creativity and guidance, love and laughter. Your advice was always just, even when it sometimes hurt. When we were with you, we were never, ever bored. In the early 1980s, I invited Mama to a home I had rented in Martha's Vineyard. Austin was hot. Martha's Vineyard rentals were cheap in June. Mama soon opted to go to the vineyard in July and August, when the enlightened luminaries descended upon the island. She located a house in heart of Vineyard Haven, and Harry provided the entertainment. I was invited as a hairdresser, errand runner, and chauffeur. These skill sets meant that Ian and I had a seat at the table. To be at Harry and Mother's table was to be submersed in the art of great conversation. Harry provided the questions of the day, and all the guests from our country's great talents in the arts, journalism, education, and politics came to opine. It was an Ivy League course in liberal arts at its best, every single night. From his last days in the Johnson White House, best was what Harry was all about. When Harry agreed to come to Texas to help Daddy write his book, he graduated from speechwriter to anointed one. Anointment meant that Harry received a POTUS line. For any of you who might possibly not know what the acronym POTUS stands for, it translates into President of the United States. This direct line to the president was a big deal to Harry. He used to tell the story of how excited he was the first time his POTUS line rang. He rushed to the phone, grabbing it with a, "Yes, Mr. President," only to hear the heavy, labored, garbling chatter of my baby Lyndon, not his grandpa Lyndon. From then on, Harry and I had a very special bond, down to the fact that my sons, Lyndon's firstborn, Tatum Nugent, discovered America on Harry's birthday. When Daddy appointed Harry as director of the LBJ Library, Harry protested, as you have already heard, claiming he didn't have the expected qualifications. Daddy reminded Harry that he had one person championing his candidacy for this job. Since that one person was Daddy and his initials were on the library, Harry ought to start preparing for the job. Start preparing is what Harry was all about, always. He would barely finish a symposium that captured the world's attention and applause before he was into planning in minute detail for the next one. Harry believed the devil was in the details, and he had a plan B for every detail that could go wrong and a plan A to make it right. Over 30 years, Harry became known as the Dean of Directors of Presidential Libraries. His vision and attention to details made him the man to emulate. He had big ideas for every symposium, exhibition, and legislative anniversary. Harry capitalized off of every historic moment to come and reason together, just as the prophet Isaiah and his admirer Lyndon Johnson thought we must. You will note that I have found the need to use both the present and the past tense when speaking about Harry. It's not just one more of my many grammatical mistakes that Harry would have, of course, corrected. It's because Harry will always be present in my heart, though I have no doubt he is now in heaven dancing with his beloved Miriam and my parents. This tribute needed the best advice that I could get. So I naturally went, as always, to Harry. Blessedly, he gave me the highlights he wanted you to know, and so straight from my hero's mouth, here they come. Harry was proudest of the opening of Daddy's presidential tapes. He believed he was the only library director directly appointed by the president. His children, Susan, Debbie, Jim, and Jennifer, are all responsible, loving, contributing adults with delightful children of their own, and he sees the good of Marion in all of them. He succeeded at including Lady Bird Johnson in the life of the LBJ Library until the day she died. He was so proud to have found a very worthy successor in Mark Updegrove. And I know, Betty Sue, he would have been so thrilled that you joined us here today from across the country. Harry treasured the voluminous positive tributes his students gave him as the best professor they ever had at the University of Texas. And most of all, he was grateful that through his efforts, the world had come to recognize Lyndon Johnson as an extraordinary and compassionate president, end quote, verbatim from His Majesty Harry. Harry convinced us all that he loved us best, including me. That was just one more of his many talents. In many ways, he was the ultimate con man. I bet every one of you in this room thought he loved you best too. But aside from his precious family, whom he adored, I will always be grateful for the love Harry gave and received from Bishop McCarthy, Shirley James, Larry Reed, Bob and Alice Hardesty, Marge Morton, Tina Houston, Tom Johnson, Larry Temple, and my sister, Lynda Robb. Harry Middleton was a professional friend. For every name I have mentioned, there are many, many more who also believed as we do. He loved them best. The summer of 2016, Harry twice showed me a letter that meant the world to him and came to me. I told him I thought it was the perfect ending to the eulogy he had asked me to make, and Harry agreed. It's a letter my father wrote to Harry just days after the Civil Rights Symposium of December 1972, and just 6 weeks before my father's death. It seems only right that my father have the last words about his friend and hero, Harry Middleton. Dear Harry, I think you know how grateful I am to you for your efforts to make the Civil Rights Symposium the success that it was. But what you might not know is how impressed I was with your deportment as master of ceremonies. So this is to express both my deep thanks and my admiration to a real pro. Sincerely, LBJ. Harry told me he treasured this letter more than any other that Daddy had given him, because he believed with all that was in him that Daddy had taken the time actually to write this letter himself. When I read it, I told him I thought once more that Harry was right, and I knew why. because Daddy had used the word deportment, and no young aide would have used such an old-fashioned word. That forever wordsmith, Harry, raised his thumb up in the air and said, "Bingo!" As usual, Daddy said it best. "Harry, in everything you did, you were a real pro. Generations of Johnsons have loved you for it, especially me."
Thank you all for coming. Dad would have been thrilled to see this crowd. And a big thank you to the LBJ Foundation, the LBJ Library, for putting on this wonderful tribute. A lot of hard work went into it. Thanks to all the speakers, to Larry, great job as MC as always. Mark, Luci, Lynda, and everybody. Thank you for mentioning all Dad's friends, Luci, and for everyone who wasn't mentioned. There are so many people who have just put a lot of effort and just been great friends of Dad. I wasn't going to speak, but I need to pick up on one thing that Josh said that ties into something that Larry said, talking about Dad's lifelong friends. He really did keep friends forever, and he kept up with their children as well. Regarding the novel Pax, I recall it was credited to Middleton Kiefer. It was a collaboration between Dad and his good friend Warren Kiefer. They had worked together at Pfizer Pharmaceutical and then wrote this novel as an expose, and Dad kept up with Warren. It's kind of a long story that goes through Italy and Argentina and Alabama and back to Austin, but Dad kept up with Warren and then his son Alden, and Alden's daughter Anna is with us tonight. We're delighted to have her, and I guess it's time to play some music now. Not yet. That wasn't your cue. We're going to do two songs. Dad picked the first, and I picked the second. The first one Dad sort of introduced to me by saying, "Jim, if I were Irish, I'd ask you to sing Danny Boy." And he did that a couple times. Then one day it just transformed to, "Jim, I'd like you to sing Danny Boy at my memorial." So that's what we're going to do, and I think that's your cue. Danny boy, the pipes are calling from glen to glen and down the mountainside. The summer's gone and all the roses falling. 'Tis you. 'Tis you must go, and I must bide. But come ye back when summer's in the meadow, or when the valley's hushed and white with snow. Shadow.
Danny boy, oh, Danny boy, I love you so.
Got Stuart Hampton helping me out on the Irish whistle, Shana Norton on the harp, Jack O'Quinn on the bass. And yeah, they're great, aren't they? So I got to pick the second song. It's one of Dad's favorites and one of my favorites too. Written in 1941 by a couple of Americans before the U.S. entry into the war, when Great Britain was just hanging on by a thread. It's kind of a nice reminder in these difficult times that we have made it through some tough times before. I'll never forget the people I met braving those angry skies. I remember well as the shadows fell, the light of hope in their eyes. And though I'm far away, I still can hear them say, thumbs up. For when the dawn comes up, there'll be bluebirds over the white cliffs of Dover tomorrow. Just you wait and see. The shepherd will tend his sheep, the valley will bloom again, and Jimmy will go to sleep in his own little room again. There'll be bluebirds over the white cliffs of Dover. Thank you.
the bluebirds over the white cliffs of Dover. Tomorrow, just you wait and see.
Thank you.
On behalf of Jim and Susan, Debbie and Jenny, one more time, I want to appreciate and thank all of you for coming to be here today. I can say with absolute certainty, that this memorial was just exactly what Harry would have wanted because he prepared it and told all of us what to do. So with that, we'll conclude, and the add at the end that he told us is that he wanted a reception upstairs in the Great Hall after this ceremony. So that is the last part, and we welcome all of you to go upstairs to the Great Hall and join us in a reception. Thanks for coming.